Well, hello, Senator Stadelman. It's good to see you. I want to tell you right off the bat, I really appreciate you making yourself available for our inaugural maiden voyage here into the YouTube realm.
It's a scary venture, isn't it?
It is a scary venture, but you know what? I mean, you know, life is all about changes and moving forward and so on and so forth. And one of the things we're really trying to do is to educate our public. It seems to me that the media is just very dry, very superficial. And so I just want to really give you a chance to kind of talk about what's going on down in Springfield and what's going on at the state government level. I mean, obviously the budget is the overriding issue. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you one of the things I find interesting is you've only been down there since you were elected in 2012?
2013, so 2.5 years.
2.5 years.
Seems like 20 years already, I'm just kidding.
Exactly. You know, and it only seems like that's how it is for most of these people who've only been there for a few years. But you've got this budget issue that's taken how long to develop?
Right. The issues have been around for 20 to 30 years. The issues that we're dealing with, you know, the seeds of the problems have been around for a really, really long time. So you're right. These are fundamental structural issues that we're still dealing with 30, 40 years later.
Or maybe they never dealt with it before and now...
Well, that's a good way to describe it, right.
That's what it almost seems like. I mean, in your view, how in the world did we get there?
It's a great question. I think the finger of blame can be pointed in many, many different directions. Both parties, Republicans and Democrats. Well, you know, there are times that Republicans have been in the governorship and Republicans have controlled the House and Senate. Same with Democrats. At some point, everybody's had a hand in creating the mess that we're dealing with right now. These issues have been around for a really long time. You know, I think, unfortunately, having been in the media and covered it from that standpoint over the years as well, you know, I think, unfortunately, sometimes people take the easy way out. Instead of making tough decisions that need to be made at that moment, you kind of you push the issues down the road, you kick the can down the road, and you don't deal with the issues because they're tough issues.
And they are hard. Oh,
and
my gosh.
Are.
If they were easy, we wouldn't have a problem.
So I think sometimes in the political world, you kind of like, well, we'll deal with it down the road. We'll kind of put a temporary patch in there, and then we'll 10, 15 years, we'll deal with that. And I think that's especially with the pension situation. And suddenly, it's time to pay the bills, and the problems surface, and you've got to deal with them. And I think we're kind of at the point right now in Illinois history that a lot of things that were, you know, kicked down the road, and now we have to deal with them. And the solutions are never, never very easy.
You know, one of the questions I guess I've got is, you know, this pension covers hundreds of thousands of workers, right? I mean, it's a whole bunch of them. We're talking about all the teachers. We're talking about, well, all the AFSCME people that work in, I mean, who's covered by the pension? We're talking police and fire.
Well, there are four or five different categories of people. You have state employees, you have teachers, you have university employees.
Prisons.
Right, so there are different categories of state employees or government employees. Police and fire are actually covered under a local government pension system, so that's separate.
Okay.
Complete different issue. Local governments have their own issues with pensions, but the state doesn't deal with police and fire. Okay. That's a different situation. But yeah, I mean, we're talking about a lot of employees, and a lot of people's lives and retirement income are affected, so some serious decisions are being made.
Absolutely. I mean, and one of the questions I've got is, it just sounds to me, what I've kind of had filtered, is that they've got their money that's going into their pension, and as opposed to staying in that account or whatever, that it had been sort of raided and filled with IOUs. Is that
right? Well, we talked about this being a long-term problem. What happened in the 90s and probably to a greater extent in the 2000s, the state, instead of making its full pension payment, decided not to pay the pension payment or borrow money to make the payment. And if you're familiar with retirement systems, whatever you don't put up front, you pay down the road.
Right, because it doesn't accrue any benefit, interest.
So, especially in the 2000s, you know, especially during the recession, when things were really tight and revenue wasn't coming in, they took the easy way out. They decided, you know, instead of making that, you know, $3, $4, or $5 billion payment, we're going to divert that money elsewhere. And that's fine. It's great for if you're in political office at the time because you're able to fund programs and not have to make cuts. But when you don't make those pension payments, the state constitution says you cannot diminish benefits. At some point down the road, you've got to pay. You got to pay the piper. And yes, so,
15 years down the road, right, that $5 billion becomes $10 billion.
Right. Or something. So what happened in the mid-90s? Actually, under a Republican governor, they created a new ramp, because in the 90s the pension problem was a huge issue as well.
Sure.
And they had it running a large deficit. So what they decided to do is change the payment schedule. And so, similar to a car loan, what they did in the mid-90s, they approved a new payment plan to pay off the liability, which was increasing greatly. They said, well, keep the payment small the first few years, you know, first 3, 4, 5 years. But around 2011, 2012, the payments are going to balloon. They're going to ramp up.
Which is very...
Well, guess what? Now we're in 2012, 2013, now we're in 2015. We're at the high end of that payment schedule. So this is a payment plan that was dictated 15, 20 years ago, but now we're paying the price, and that ramp, we're at the top of the ramp. So when we talk about squeezing out other areas of the budget, that's what we're dealing with right now. According to the pension ramp that was approved in the mid-90s, we're at that high point. We're paying a lot of money to
make up for
what wasn't put in years ago, and that squeezes out other areas of the budget. We don't have as much money for education, healthcare, important programs the state provides. So
Absolutely. That's
really, given a historical perspective, where we're at right now and why pensions are becoming such a big deal, simply because of decisions that were made 15, 20 years ago.
So then I'm going to throw a few talking points, because that's all people seem to get is the talking points. Okay, so as you've just described, the idea that, well, it's this blue state and the Democrats did it. Okay, we understand that that's not necessarily true. That there were a lot of people that were in office during that period of time. Matter of fact, Illinois almost has as many Republican governors as Democratic governors, actually. I guess I'd have to check the prison records, but...
And there's a lot of records to check, unfortunately.
That's right. So that's kind of the first talking point. The other one that I wanted to talk about is that whole spending is out of control in Springfield. Is it really spending is out of control, or is it that this schedule now has just reached the high point, and I guess that's spending, but...
Well, it is spending.
You're obligated.
Right. We just had a court case in this year that there was a pension reform that passed,
right,
and
Governor Quinn's.
And kind of reduced the cost of living adjustments. And it was taken to court, and the state Supreme Court said it was unconstitutional. Illinois is one of those states that has very explicit language in the state constitution that says you cannot diminish benefits. And everybody thought it was going to be proven unconstitutional, and it was. So you're right. I mean, you can complain about that spending, but the state constitution says you've got to protect people's retirement income. So again, it makes it much more complicated to try to resolve some very... very real problems.
I think the problem I've got with the connotation of spending is out of control. It's like you guys are finding things, new things to spend money on. That's what the connotation of that, and it's deceiving.
Well, actually, during the recession, after recession, state government services were cut back quite a bit because there wasn't as much revenue coming in.
Sure.
The amount of money that was going for education, it was prorated. They weren't getting their full amount. Social services were cut dramatically. You talk to nonprofits and providers of some human service programs. For a while there, 4 or 5 years ago, especially mental health services, they suffered a lot of cutbacks. And unfortunately, they're back in the situation right now. But
what was the mental health place of Janet Wiles?
Yeah.
I mean, that merged with, I think it's Rosecrans or something, because they just had to merge. There wasn't the money.
So, in a sense that obviously you want to make government as efficient as possible, but people talk about the temporary income tax increase that was passed in 2011, pretty controversial.
Sure.
It basically went for two things. It went, one, to make sure that the state would pay its pension payments in full, which wasn't being done up until a few years ago, which allowed us to get in the situation. It also went to pay off the debt associated with those pension payments. And we also pay down the backlog of bills. So at one point in 2011, the state was $10.5 billion backlog of bills. At one point last year, we were down to $3.5 billion.
So
in any business, you have probably a 30-day payment cycle.
Sure.
A 30-day payment cycle for the state is roughly $3 billion. We were within paying our bills 30 to 60 days at one point last year. So that's where all that revenue went, okay? Why we're in a fiscal crisis right now in 2015 is because, as you know, the income tax rate went from 5% to 3.75% at the beginning of the year. That is a $4 billion hit to state revenues. So in a matter of one day, one fiscal year, we lost 25% of our revenue immediately. So if that income tax increase went to pay off pensions and pay down the debt, that money's gone. You don't have that money to pay off pensions and to pay down the debt, right? So that squeezes out everything else in the budget. So when you lose $4 billion in revenue immediately, you want to make government as efficient as possible, but that's a huge hit to take. So that's why we're in the fiscal crisis that we are right now.
I'm so glad that you touched on that, because I don't want this to be the Jay show, but what I'm going to tell you is I didn't like it when Quinn's tax increase went in. I mean, I can't say that I liked it, you know.
No, but
I also can't honestly tell you that I had trouble paying my bills or living my life or anything with the, you know, increased tax rate. And then when the rate went away, it's not like I suddenly felt rich, okay? And I'm just speaking personally, and it'll be interesting to see what our audience says about this, but I'm more unnerved by every other day I'm hearing that retirement homes aren't get their money, or that my daughter works at a daycare center, and a lot of these people need vouchers in order to afford the daycare. I mean, you get somebody who's only making $400, $500 a week, it's hard to pay $130 a week for childcare. And there are people that aren't able to put their kids in childcare. Where are they going? Are they going to welfare now? I mean, it just seems, I'm so unnerved by all of that there isn't money for rail.
You know, childcare never used to be a political football. It was part of the welfare to work initiative.
Yes.
That was back in the mid-90s and under President Clinton. It was a way for people to transition from government assistance to the workforce, because they realized that missing component was childcare,
right?
Having a safe place for your child to be while you were able to work. And it never was a political football. It was always a bipartisan issue. Republicans and Democrats always agreed this is something we need to maintain. Mm-hmm. Suddenly that's changed in Springfield. It's become a political football. And you know, the new administration has changed the eligibility requirements, and that's separate from our budget debate. You know, the new administration has unilaterally changed the eligibility requirements for parents who will be able to get help with their child care costs. So
they reduced the amount.
People who would make minimum wage, I think, no longer qualify. For child care services. And so what this does is puts pressure on the parent. Do I continue working, or do I stay home and because I can't afford child care? What's that do to our economy? What's that to do to businesses and their productivity? If you have an employee who can't be at work and it's been trained by the employer, that's not good for business either. That's not good for the economy. But I think it's symptomatic of what we're dealing with in Springfield. More things have become political footballs that weren't in the past. And I think childcare is a perfect example of how it's really frustrating that, you know, there are important programs that actually save the state money, are good for the economy, good for business, like childcare, or, for example, services that keep seniors in their homes, or those who have disabilities in their homes.
Right.
If those services are discontinued,
visiting nurse can come and such. Right?
They're going to go to an institution, a nursing home, which is far more expensive for the state to care for. So there's an expression, penny wise, pound foolish. A lot of the programs that aren't being funded fit in that category. We may save some money initially by not providing those services, but if people end up in nursing homes, institutions, incarcerated, or jailed because teens, for example, don't have after-school programs, don't get the mentoring they need, it's going to cost the state much more money down the road. And sometimes when we talk about the budget and balancing a budget, and we talk about where we need to be fiscally, you need to think long-term as well. A lot of these programs save the state money, and I think we need to take that into consideration as far as how we get through our budget crisis.
You know, when it comes to the child care thing, that's not an abstract thing. My daughter works at a child care place. She works there part-time. She loves the kids, just loves them. And but their enrollment is down since, because there are people that just can't drop their kids off. And these are folks that I'm sure have difficulties now going to work.
Yeah, I'm sure they are.
And these are people that are making, oh gosh, you know, they're making $12, maybe $14 an hour, you know, which, hell, you know, that's not all the money in the world, but that's out there making it happen. But if you can't send your kid to childcare while you go to work, you can't go to work. Either that or else you're going to, what, lock your kid in the house with a bowl of Cheerios or something? I mean, you know, you have to make choices between being a responsible parent and, I don't know.
Or likely you're not going to work and you're going to go on a government assistance program.
That's exactly what all these folks are going to do. That's exactly what's happening. So, I don't know. I guess the moral of that story is that I feel more ill at ease now after getting that wonderful tax break than I did when I was paying the higher tax rate, which I didn't like necessarily. I mean, I wasn't drinking San Adams beer at that point. I was drinking Killian's, you know, because I couldn't afford it. But that's about as much as it affected my life. But I look out here now, and it's really scary.
There are a lot of nonprofits for a number of different reasons, because of court orders, consent decrees, and actually bills Governor Browner has signed, 90% of the budget is being paid for. It's going out the door. Government services are being provided. The governor decided to go to court to make sure state employees were being paid, which is fine. Mm-hmm. People can continue to get state government services.
Sure.
But 10% of the budget that's not being funded are for nonprofit providers. And those nonprofit providers really provide the programs for the state regarding human services, child care.
Like the child care.
And because that they're part of the 10% that are not being funded by the state, they're in danger over the next few weeks, few months of going out of business. And the state of Illinois has set up this infrastructure through these nonprofits.
That depends on them.
That depends on them. And so if they start going out of business, you're going to see that structure crumble quickly. And you can't build that back up. I mean, because good people who are dedicated, they're educated,
they move on.
They've got to find ways to make a living. And if and when that budget situation is resolved, you don't build up that infrastructure that the state relies on so heavily to provide some very needed programs that quickly. So, you know, the ramifications are great.
Yeah.
People, if they haven't already, will be hurt, or even more seriously, people can die. I mean, that's the ramifications of what we're dealing with by not having a budget agreement. And, you know, I understand the frustration. People want to point fingers and play the blame game. That doesn't get us anywhere. At the end of the day, we have divided government. We have a Republican governor. We have a Democratic-controlled General Assembly. Neither side is going to get everything they want. You've got to find a compromise. You got to find middle ground, or else nothing's going to accomplish. And that's the situation right now. So I understand the frustration, because people just want to know, why aren't you doing your jobs? And you're right. You know, the bottom line is, you know, we need to agree on a budget and make sure important services are funded. So it's frustrating. And at some point, there's got to be a will to find that middle ground. So it doesn't mean that I'm going to agree with everything that Governor Rauner is putting out there, but you still need to find a way to compromise and come together, because when you have divided government, You've got to make that work.
You know, maybe this is just sort of a suggestion, but in my little feeble mind, it almost is a choice between how we've got this budget problem, and we're either going to solve it by raising taxes or by cutting services. Now, that's a very binary way to look at it, and probably way too black and white. But it helps people focus on it, just to say, well, okay, if we were going to do it by raising taxes alone, how much would that median household of $55,000 in Illinois, whatever it is, how much would their taxes go up if all we were going to do was raise taxes? And then on the other hand is, what if we didn't raise taxes at all and all we did was cut things? What would have to be cut? I think that would be an interesting thing to look at.
Yeah. Well, the reality is, first of all, because our budget situation has gotten so much worse in the past 9 months, the answer is you need a combination of both. You need a balanced approach. You just can't cut your way out of it, and you certainly can't tax your way out of it. I think most people, you know, I think have always believed.
Fundamentally understand.
Yeah,
that.
I think you've got to have a combination of both, because both sides are too much of the extreme. So that's part of the compromise, finding some middle ground. Even Governor Rauner has now indicated that revenue has to be part of the picture. So there's an acknowledgement now that has to be part of discussion.
Well, that's a step in the right direction.
Right, but he wants other things in his political agenda as part of preconditions for him talking about the budget, and that's where the stalemate is. It's not about budget numbers and coming to an agreement as far as spending and revenue. Right. It's about ideology. It's about politics. Those are harder things to resolve. We need a combination of both. But I said, both sides really are not that far apart when it comes to budget numbers. Like I said, when the tax rate dropped, we lost $4 billion in revenue. So the governor proposed a budget back in February. It was roughly $3 billion unbalanced. The General Assembly passed a budget later that May with about $4 billion unbalanced, all right? Both sides' spending plans are pretty similar. Both sides had cuts to programs. Mm-hmm. Remarkably, the spending programs were pretty similar. So here you can see the broad outline of budget agreement. You know, both sides have a relative idea as far as how much revenue it would take because the governor's plan was unbalanced and so was the General Assembly plan, and you have somewhat of agreement on the spending priorities. So you have a broad outline of agreement. We can have this resolved tomorrow. It was just about adding up the budget numbers. But as I said, it's about ideology and it's about politics. The ideology is his political agenda. Are a lot of things that deal with collective bargaining rights for workers, policies that I think lower wages. Personally, I don't think that leads to economic development. Personally, I don't think that's what we need as a state to move forward. That's the governor's political agenda. We have divided government. We got to find ways to compromise on that political agenda. I understand that. Mm-hmm. And I think there are ways for both sides to claim victories. But I also said it's about politics. It's about politics because we have an election coming up next year. Yeah. And frankly, both sides are trying to get leverage out of a budget impasse, a budget disagreement, to point blame at the other side, or to posture themselves as, our way is a better way. This will give us an advantage in the 2016 election.
Sure.
And that's, unfortunately, in my opinion, it's not about the budget, it's about ideology and politics. That's the stalemate, and then those are harder things to resolve.
Oh my gosh, that sounds so much like Washington. At least what I'm looking at, I understand Washington much better than I do Springfield, so I just love this conversation. But it does seem like this is just the rise of the ideologues that they've decided that if we can only destroy the unions, then it'll all get better. Well, how much weaker do these guys got to get? You know what I'm saying?
It's like 12% of the workforce.
It used to be 30%. Well, why isn't it 20% better now that you've busted them all up?
Yeah.
I just don't know that eradicating unions is definitely the answer. There's probably some work that you can do within that regard. I mean,
I said there are areas to compromise. But taking people's collective bargaining rights away, which the government wants to do for teachers, and
kind of like the guy in Wisconsin,
right, that is a much more a fundamental issue that is harder to resolve. I mean, there are many Republicans that don't agree with taking collective bargaining rights away from employees. But you mentioned Washington, D.C. style politics, and I think you kind of hit it right on the head with that. It's not so much about forging a compromise. It's about putting obstruction in place. It's about posturing for the next election. Nothing moves. You have stalemates. As we know in Washington, D.C., nothing's been happening for years, right?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
And
it's
so,
about breaking something and then blaming the other side.
Right. And then I think, in a way, that's what we've seen in Springfield the past 9 months. It's not a matter about let's get people together, hash out our differences. It's about it's their fault. They're to blame. That's all we've been hearing the past 9 months. So there's no effort to try to govern. It's more about staying on the campaign trail. Unfortunately, there's some similarities from what has happened in Washington, D.C. and kind of what we're seeing in Springfield right now.
Oh my gosh, you know what? I just popped in my head. A while back, you guys were talking about the budget, and there was like, it was like a campaign ad that was coming out.
Yeah, it was a
It was a campaign.
We're discussing a budget.
And it was the People for Responsible Illinois or something, and then you look behind it, it's like Governor Rauner and like two of his buddies. That's all there was in this people for the responsible Illinois. I don't know if that was even the name of
there's it. There's a number of groups associated ridiculous. With that. Yeah.
And I thought to myself, it's not even an election year. Why am I seeing a campaign commercial?
Yeah, in May is when we tried to negotiate a budget.
Yeah.
And instead of being at the table, there were negative TV commercials on the air. There were negative mailers being sent in individual lawmakers' districts. So you're right. Instead of sitting down, negotiating a budget, already the negative attack ads have taken place. And that's very
political style.
That's very Washington, D.C. style politics.
Yeah, it was like, what was that, a super PAC or something? What the heck?
It was, there are groups that align themselves with certain political causes, and so they will independently fund these types of campaigns. And
I'll have to look it up and get the exact name.
There's a number of them out there, yeah. And get used to it, because as I said, the 2016 election is right around the corner. You're going to see a lot more of that over the next year.
It's going to be, well, yeah, and we're used to that in the silly season of politics. It's the propaganda season, you know, so let's kind of go from there, right?
Yeah, it's a former mayor Charles Box called it silly season. It's a perfect way to describe it because, you know, the accusations fly and it's talking points and it's not about policy, it's about politics.
Now, were there changes that have happened to the teachers' pensions? I heard somebody talking that, well, gee, you have to be 67 before you can get benefits now as a teacher, and that was a change?
Right. Back in 2011, they approved another pension plan for new employees. So new if you were hired after 2011, you are under a Tier 2 pension plan.
Gosh. And the just like the Chrysler guys.
Yes, similar. Yeah. So the benefits were greatly reduced. It extended the time you could retire. Yeah, so those benefits for pension two or tier two pension are much different than those who've been, working for the state for a long time. Dramatically reduced benefits. So in a way, people.
How is that legal?
Well, these are new employees, so you can set the rules for new employees.
I get it.
But it's those employees that are working before 2011 that some of the changes that were proposed last year that were found unconstitutional. You can't diminish benefits for current employees, but.
Sure.
You can change the rules for the new people who are coming in.
You just can't diminish their benefits now that you offer them a diminished plan. You can't diminish it further.
Right.
Because they're now employees.
And actually, eventually, we have some long-term pension liability plans, but and there's some concerns that under federal law, you have to provide, as an employer, pension benefits are equal to what Social Security provides. There's some concern that the Tier 2 pension system doesn't provide even that level of benefit. So, I think long-term that resolves the state situation as, we get further down the road and more employees retire and those in the tier two, eventually the system will work its way out. It's gonna be costly, obviously, once those tier one people retire, but, it's down the road, this situation probably eventually will resolve itself, but it doesn't mean there isn't pain in the meantime.
Well, and that's one of the questions that I had. I did a little research, and I think a lot of people don't understand that teachers don't get Social Security in Illinois. That the money that I'm paying, that 6% that I send to Social Security and my employer sends to Social Security, that's not happening with teachers at all.
Mm-hmm.
So when, and this is subject to a lot of propaganda because someone will say, oh my gosh, here's this teacher and they're getting $6,000 a month or something as their pension, and people go, wow, that's an awful lot. But really? I mean, when you add up your Social Security and your 401k after working someplace for 30 years, it just sounds like American retirement to me. And I think a lot of people don't understand that.
No,
but
people realize that teachers don't get Social Security. You're right. Well, I think it was a decision made a long time ago.
That's a long
time. People often say, well, let's just turn all employees onto Social Security and 401ks.
Yeah.
But it's more complex and may actually cost the state more money.
Because you've got a match.
You've got a lot of employers match, and you still have the Social Security tax that an employer has to pay. So you combine a 401k match with a Social Security tax that the government has to pay.
6% plus whatever.
4%. You're paying more than what the state is paying at 9% right now for pensions. So it'd be more costly, especially initially, to switch. So, it's very complex, and it may not save the state money. It may cost the state even more money to say, let's switch everybody to Social Security.
So it's actually, it would be, the most cost-effective thing would be to fund the pensions at the levels that they're supposed to, just do what you're supposed to do.
Well,
if they'd have done what they were supposed to do, they would have saved money from, as compared to Social Security plus 401k match.
Yeah, I think that's what the, you know, the unions argue, is that if lawmakers over the years just would have funded it adequately along the way and made sure the payments were made, we would not be in the situation right now, and that's a legitimate, it's a legitimate complaint.
And maybe it's the weakness of the union. The union should have been, they should have been screaming bloody murder that that wasn't being funded. I kind of remember hearing something.
Yeah,
about
but
that.
You know, I think remember we were in a different investment times. In the 1990s, stock market was skyrocketing.
It was.
I think people thought things were going to just continually go up, right? Well, we had the crash. Investments weren't turning out the way they were supposed to. So I think people, and I don't want to try to make excuses for some very bad policy decisions that were made, but I think back then they thought, well, you can make it up down the road because the stock market's going to continue to go up.
Just like the housing bubble.
Yeah, and so guess what? We had that huge that crash. Financially, things were very insecure. That changed the dynamics as far as policy decisions. So I'm not giving them an excuse back 10, 20 years for their decisions, but I think in the mindset those decisions were made.
You got to understand where people
a little bit.
Are
but again, I think anybody knows that when you have to fund a retirement system, anything you do not to pay money up front, you pay in the back end. So that's just common fiscal sense. So what happened was just not good fiscal policy that for those who were responsible back then.
Right. And the opposite of this, if we're getting any young kids on YouTube, the money that you invest right away in the first few years is the best money to invest because it doubles and doubles and doubles, you know, as you go on. So it's kind of the same way. This whole miracle of compound interest is it's something else, you know. Let me think here. There's been a lot of talk in Illinois. Illinois has a flat tax as opposed to a progressive tax, and that's something that I became aware of recently. And you always hear people saying, oh, we need this flat tax, we need this flat tax. Does a flat tax actually collect more money than a progressive tax?
It depends. It depends how it's structured. And yeah, Illinois is one of the few states that does have a flat tax.
Yeah.
It's regressive. If you make $20,000, you pay the same
5%
tax rate as someone who makes $1 million. In fact, when we had the tax rate cut this year, went from 5 to 3.75%, most was probably, you talked about how much money you was in your check,
yeah.
Most was probably 30, 40, 50, 60, 70,000, or 70,000,
yeah.
I wish, 30,
yeah.
40, 50, 60,
yeah.
$70 a month,
right.
Most of us would see in a paycheck.
Sure.
Bruce Runner, he saved $750,000, $750,000 with the pay cut, with the cut in taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is that fair?
No,
we have a tax cut.
I don't think it's fair.
And that's who benefited, you know, from that tax cut. So, flat, you know, taxes are inherently regressive. So, and Illinois is one of the few states that has that. Again, I don't think people who make $20,000 should be paying less. I think than someone who has say $1 million salary.
Well, right, and it's that money gets important as you get lower and lower on that system. And I guess I'm going to go on my little bit of a rant. I talk about this with just people I work with, and they're just regular folks, you know, at Woodward's, and talking about this flat tax. And all people are like, I think a flat tax would be really, really fair. Oh, except for the people that make maybe 25 grand or less or whatever, because they don't make that much money and they should get a break. And I find it so heartwarming that regular people can say, hey, look, there are people that are making a third of what I make or a half of what I make, and I got to give them a break. But people that are making 100 friggin' times what I make can't seem to come to that same conclusion, you know? I mean, there are people out there making $120,000, $150,000 a week, you know? And they can't come to the conclusion that, well, gee, maybe we better give these little $50,000 a year guys a break, right? I don't know what goes on in the mind of people that I just don't understand that.
You know, fortunately, you know, I think tax reform is something that needs to be looked at, but it doesn't solve our immediate problems, however, because any change in our tax code has to be, one, approved by the General Assembly, which is no guarantee. I mean, it's a controversial issue. Then it has to be put on the ballot. Then it has to be approved by voters. So we're looking at a 1-2 year process. So that doesn't solve our immediate issue, our fundamental issues that we're for 2016 right now. I mean, that's more of a longer term situation that, you know, people want to look at as far as tax reform, but it doesn't solve our immediate crisis.
Immediate problems. Well, I really appreciate you kind of opening up. I guess I got one little ringer question here. You got a favorite in the Democratic Party? Is it too early?
Nah, I think it's too early. I mean, I think everybody assumes Hillary Clinton is the leader at this point. Everybody's waiting to see whether the vice president jumps in. And honestly, you know, the media attention has been focused on Hillary Clinton and more of the Republican side of it. So I really
because Trump is a nut.
Yeah,
oh my God.
He's getting all the publicity, right? Well, he's getting all the publicity, to put it that way.
Right.
So I would like to see some of the other Democratic candidates that haven't received as much publicity and see more what they have to say. So.
We'll see that next Tuesday, because you know.
Yeah, right, you know, it's still actually it's not that far away, but we still got ways to go. I mean, the first ballots won't be cast until early next year, and it's still kind of a media game and who's leading who in the polls, and that's kind of what the game is right now.
Right. You know, and I mean, when people are trolling each other and doing the things that are out there right now, they just can't be serious. So, although I have to tell you, with Trump, I can't stop watching that guy. And I feel guilty about it. You know, a couple years ago, I was hooked on this show called Mob Wives. It was the trashiest show you ever saw, Steve. I mean, these ladies were cussing each other. They were going to fight. They were all gaudy. They had crazy makeup. And I couldn't stop watching this terrible show. And that's what I feel like when I watch Trump. I'm like, I got to get home and see what this guy said. Then I feel like, oh, I don't want anybody to know I was really watching.
Secretly watching exactly. Donald Trump tapes.
Yeah, but, you know, I'm lying to him. I was watching, you know, History 2 that day.
But how would you like to be a Republican candidate and you know, all the media attention is focused on Donald Trump? He says something and that's the soundbite you see on the evening news.
Right.
That's the only person who gets covered. So if there are 15 or 16 of you, it's got to be extremely frustrating trying to jockey for any
especially
awareness.
If you're a serious person, you know, because I don't know what he's going to do next. He's going to make a noise out of his underarm. This guy's a nut. But,
yeah, I think he taps into a certain segment of the voters, though. You know, people were really frustrated, and he taps in. He's a showman. He's an expert showman. I think he knows how to generate publicity, and he knows how to connect via the media. So, you know, he's got some skills along those lines, no doubt.
Well, and there's definitely a segment of the population that thinks that belligerence is the most important thing. But, Steve, I want to really thank you for making yourself available. Is there anything else that you'd like to add that we haven't covered? Or?
Well, you know...
I wanted to ask you something. Even though there's been all of this gridlock and so on and so forth, have you been able to advance anything?
You know, despite the big picture items that are still unresolved, I mean, as a lawmaker, you still continue to do things to benefit your community, specific pieces of legislation that aren't directly impacted by the budget. And probably one of the biggest things I dealt with over the spring session was helping victims of domestic violence. We know it's a huge problem in this community, across the state, across the country. And it's a big reason crime rates are high. Mm-hmm. I think when you ask police, it's probably the number one issue in trying to get a handle on crime is, how do we prevent domestic violence? And what my legislation does, one of the biggest obstacles for a victim to receive help is because of finances. Maybe they don't work, or maybe they don't have a well-paying job. And so just to pack up yourself and your kids and move, you know, that's a financial consideration involved in that as well.
People feel trapped.
Right. So, you know, one thing I introduced legislation, was passed and signed by the governor this summer. It allows victims to put off their deposits for utility bills. If you're thinking about moving to a new place, for example, right? You're going to have to put a deposit for gas, electric, and other utilities. And that can be several hundred dollars. That's an obstacle people may have as far as, okay, I'm going to make this move, but I can't because I can't afford it. So what the legislation requires is, or allows domestic violence victims to have a 60-day waiver of paying those deposits. They still have to pay them, But it gives them some time to get their finances ordered so they can make the move, remove themselves from a bad situation, and hopefully in a small way, that can make an impact. Give someone incentive, the encouragement to get out of a bad situation, and hopefully that prevents problems down the road.
Sure.
The other thing it does, if you're in a shelter right now, if you're able to, because of this program, it's not really a program, but just it's an allows,
policy.
Requires, utilities to waive the deposit. It doesn't cost the state any money. But if you're able to move out of a shelter to renting a place, that opens up more beds in a shelter and allows more victims to move in there. So in a way, I think it's one piece of the puzzle in trying to resolve a very, very important problem. So yeah, legislation continues. Things
Good.
Continue
Some
to work down.
Is getting
yeah.
done.
You know, the governor did pass the education budget, the one piece of legislation he did sign. We were able to tweak the school funding formula this year that greatly benefited the Rockford School District. The district received an extra $11 million.
Oh, good.
We were able to make sure that the state kept it more of its commitment this year, but also tweak the formula because right now, and I don't want it's kind of a complicated, detailed subject, but our school aid formula right now, this main way that we pay local school districts, really is unfair to school districts that have low property values. And Rockford has low property values, high poverty levels, right?
Right.
So we have a low tax, low base, but we have very high tax rates, and that causes one versus the other. You take a suburb in a school district in a suburb of Chicago. They have great property values, but their tax rates are very low.
Because you don't have to tax at a very high percent if you're taxing a $300,000
right.
house.
So then you generate it with a higher tax rate. But Rockford, with low and even more declining property values, the tax rate goes up to try to recoup the money we can't get from our low values. And as you know, your property tax bill, 50% of it goes to school districts.
Right.
So Rockford's always been at a disadvantage when it comes to school funding formula because it penalizes those school districts that have low property values. And I mentioned I compared the school district in the suburbs. They spend maybe $20,000 per student. Rockford spends maybe $11,000-$12,000 per student.
Oh my gosh.
But our tax rate is 3 or 4 times higher than a suburban tax rate. Isn't that crazy?
It is crazy.
The wealth is there, but our tax rate, which is is very high in this community.
Mm-hmm.
Our tax rate high, but we can't afford that tax rate because we have low property values. So we need to change the school funding formula to make sure that school districts like Rockford aren't penalized. You know, we passed a bill a year ago to try to tweak that formula. What we did with this, the education bill that was a co-sponsor of this year, we provided some extra dollars, some extra help for those school districts that are penalized under the current school funding formula. So those are ways that, as a local lawmaker, you continue to represent your district,
and help out. And that resulted in, how much did you say?
$11 million extra this year.
And
so
a wonderful thing.
That makes sure, programs are there, teachers aren't cut, but it helps keep the pressure off and increasing the tax rate, so
yes.
Everybody benefits. So
that's right.
I think that was an important accomplishment despite the lack of a budget agreement.
My son was playing baseball a few years ago for District 205 school, and they traveled into Chicago, and they're playing baseball at this place. It's like, oh my gosh, they got lacrosse fields. These guys got, he's like, oh man,
And they do it for a third, only a third of the tax rate.
Yeah, and he was coming home. It's like I felt like opening up a fire hydrant when, just after going from that one world to another.
But. You should, where you live and what your zip code is should not determine the quality of education
right.
in the state.
Right.
And under our current system and its reliance on property taxes, that's the way the state funds education. That's got to be changed. Efforts to reform the funding formula will continue, and they need to continue.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much, Steve.
No, thanks for the opportunity. I'm pleased to be the first guinea pig in your new venture.
You are.
I you always do wonderful things, whether it's on the radio or on the website. You've always been an important voice for the Rockford community, so keep it up.
Thank you very much. I take that as a great compliment from you. Thank you much.